Good morning, everyone. Welcome. If you have had your device in gallery view to watch as everybody arrived, I encourage you now to choose speaker view. That should be a button up in the right-hand corner of your screen. You'll know you've got it right when you see my shining face filling your screen. So I've got a couple of things I'd like to share with you. This idea came too late to make it into the announcements that we showed during the prelude. Cheryl was noticing that whenever we meet, the conversation seems to drift towards the election, and she was noticing how anxious people are feeling about it. I know elections are always stressful, but this year the tensions are extra high, and lots of us are alone. So Cheryl had the idea of opening a Zoom drop-in for anybody who wants to get together and talk after Tuesday night's debate. We don't endorse particular candidates around here, but we do support each other when we're feeling angry or frightened or stressed. So here's the information. This Tuesday at 7:30, countdown to election night, there will be a similar meeting after the vice presidential debate on October 7th, and then the debates switch to Thursdays. And then it will be election night. But Cheryl has created a Zoom link for anybody who wants to debrief or rehash or vent or watch election returns, all those good things. And we'll put the details in the weekly email. This is a picture of a spice market in Istanbul. I absolutely love it. Can you imagine how amazing it would smell as you walk nearby? And what a feast for the eyes, all those fabulous colors and the promise of it. Buy a few herbs and spices in little brown twists of paper. Take them home and pinch a bit of this and a bit of that into your cooking. Savor it as the aroma fills the house. Those flavors make life worth living. I offer you this picture as an image of our lives as we pass the six-month mark and enter into a new season of this crazy year. The South African friends who have been worshiping with us are welcoming the spring now, but for us in the north, the days are shortening, and we are very conscious of the approach of winter. For many of us, feelings are running high. Let the beauty and variety and promise of the spice market guide how we live with our feelings. For the next five Sundays, we're going to look at stories of Jesus to remind ourselves of the emotionally intense life he led. He was not aloof and superior and above all the rough and tumble of what we experience. He chose to dwell right in the thick of it. Looking to him will help us navigate our own emotional journeys as these next weeks and months unfold. And today we begin by looking at the ways that he loved. So come, you who are chipper and you who are struggling, you who have it all together and you who wonder if you can take any more, you whose hearts break when you watch the news, you who are afraid, you who are good at shrugging off your worries and you who can't stop thinking about them. We are human and God loves us and we have strong help to see us through. Let's sing a hymn of gratitude together.
Praise with elation. Let us pray together. Giver of life, maker of truth, way of wisdom, all glory be to you here among us. Be light in our darkness, hope in our despair, love in our fear. Offer us grace for our failings, joy for our tears, and strength for our weakness. Bring us connection in our disunity, understanding in our confusion, and recognition in our lostness. We come to you as the secure ground of our very being. No matter what challenges we face, your constant caring presence is our strength, our freedom, and our song. We worship you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Steve, for leading us in prayer. 2 days ago, Steve and I put our signatures to a document that sets the course for his internship with our congregation, which lasts from now until the end of May. The document we signed, though, was just for these next few months, huh, Steve? For those of you who haven't met him yet, Steve is a student at Claremont Theological Seminary and a member in discernment with our Pacific Northwest Conference of the United Church of Christ. That all means that he's well on his way toward becoming a minister, and we're going to help as he tries his hand at all the different tasks of ministry. Last weekend, Steve shared his story with the church council, and I'd like to ask him to share it with all of you now, and then to tell you what he wrote in that blueprint about the first few months of his internship with us. And then we will pray for him and the ministry that he's going to be sharing. Steve.
Thank you, Roberta. So just kind of a brief overview of my spiritual history. I grew up in the church, a cradle Christian, if you will, and I was born into the Lutheran denomination and spent many years there all throughout my childhood. And as I got older, I was actually very fortunate in that my stepdad was somebody who liked to experience new church environments. And so I was exposed to a lot of different denominations and styles of worship, and it was a really great experience. About the age of 16, I experienced a very distinct, direct calling from God. Probably one of the only times I've really heard God's voice in a very audible way, and said, "I want you in ministry." To which I laughed and said, "No, thank you," and tried to move on with my life. I have never been a public speaker. I was always terrified to be in front of anybody. And that was just too much for me to handle, especially because it was very clear that I was to go into pulpit ministry. And that obviously involves a lot of public speaking. Over the years, I kind of feel like God had forgotten about that. I don't know why. It never seems to work out that way, but that's the way I felt. In my early 20s, I joined the Methodist Church, and I was very involved in ministry, music ministry the whole time, but pulpit ministry was never on the table for me. I eventually got involved with a retreat group, and throughout that time, I was, unbeknownst to me, learning all the skills, or a lot of the skills, that I would need to overcome all those objections that I kept putting out to God. And throughout that time there with that organization, a couple of friends of mine who were pastors kept approaching me, "Have you thought about going into ministry?" Which I again laughed at and moved on. But one of my very, very dear friends, and actually the woman who married my wife and I, she really sat down with me and said, "We need to do some discernment. I know you've said that you had been called to ministry, but put it off. But I think we need to talk about that more." And so over the course of a couple months, it became very clear that I had overcome a lot of those obstacles, and that indeed God was still calling me to ministry. So I started the process of ordination in the Methodist Church. But as many of you know, there's a lot of tension right now in that church and a lot over human sexuality. And it was something that I could not agree with. And along with several other factors, I just thought it was not the best fit for me. And so I had been to a couple United Church of Christ churches in the past and decided I wanted to look into that. And this is about a little over 5 years ago now. And found my home at Spirit of Peace in Sammamish. And they supported me right from the very beginning. And very, very grateful for that. And so now, about a year and a half ago, I started at Claremont School of Theology. And here I am now. I'm about halfway through the process. And this is the part where I have to go out into the field, as it were, and be part of a church and learn how to do the business of church, how to help run a church. And Roberta has graciously offered her help with that and her tutelage, and I am very, very appreciative of that. The document that she talked about is pretty simple, but it basically kind of lays out what we're going to be working on over the next couple months. Helping plan worship and liturgy is a big part of it. It's something that I enjoy, but I don't have a whole lot of experience with. Pastoral counseling. In whatever form that may take. And I'm blanking right now on what some of the other things were. We had four main points.
We had four, didn't we? I can remember one of the other ones was about outreach, thinking about who we should be reaching out to as a church next.
Yep. And if you'll forgive me, I forget the other one off the top of my head. I'm sorry about that. But
I'm sure it's terribly important. But thank you. Thanks very much, Steve. We really welcome your contributions. We welcome them with enthusiasm. And we would like to commission you to your serving and learning in our midst in the name of Christ. So I want everybody to try something. I asked you to go into speaker view. If you could go back to that button in the upper right-hand corner and go into gallery view again. And those of you who have your video turned off, if you would condescend to turn it on for a few moments, it's your call, but that would be good. I want to ask that you raise your hands in blessing. Imagine raising them in Steve's direction so that we can pray for him together. Just imagine the love and the power of God flowing through these hands to surround and embrace him. Steve, we who are the Congregational Church on Mercer Island commission you to this work and pledge to you our prayers, our encouragement, and our support. May the Holy Spirit guide and strengthen you, that in this and all things you may do God's will in the service of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Gracious and adventurous God, we thank you for Steve. Thank you for your nudging and calling and equipping and encouraging in his life. Thank you for leading him to us. The time will probably go by quickly. Fill it with your power. Strengthen Steve in the midst of all the demands on his time and energies. Bless his family. Bless the congregation at Spirit of Peace UCC who will be missing him. Give him vision, patience, and courage, and strengthen us all in the ministry we share, growing into the body of Christ together and reaching out into the world in his name. Amen. That worked, I think. Steve, consider yourself commissioned. And now let's all go back into speaker view because I would like to call on Debbie Brown and she will introduce Marilyn Cornwell to us, and between them, they have a new study opportunity to tell us about.
Thanks, Roberta, and good morning, everybody. Roberta approached Marilyn Cornwall and me many, many months ago to gauge our interest in leading some form of a book or study group focused on racism. And then COVID hit, and we understandably hit the pause button. But certainly what has happened over the last few months has only added to the urgency to this conversation. And I am delighted to say that we have decided to move ahead with the study group. And I want to emphasize study versus book. Because it really is a learning group. And we've entitled it, Let's Talk About Racism. And I'm even more happy to have the opportunity to co-lead this group with Marilyn Cornwell. Many of you, or some of you may know Marilyn, but I'd like to just spend a minute and tell you a little bit more about her. Marilyn relocated to Mercer Island and to Seattle in 1991 with her husband and her son. Marilyn at the time was a cancer research scientist before her ordination as an Episcopal priest. Since becoming a priest, she served as a pastor in several area churches and also served as a council member or a member of the diocese anti-racism committee. Although retired, Marilyn continues to be very active in social causes. So you can see why I'm so excited to co-lead with Marilyn. And Marilyn, I think at this point I'm going to turn it over to you and let you speak a bit about the hopes and intentions for our group.
Thank you, Debbie, and how lovely to be with all of you today. I want to talk about our purpose and some of our assumptions, our intention, and our hope for this dialogue or study group. Our purpose is to provide a virtual space for anyone who's interested in joining us to engage in dialogue about racism and the structures that keep it in place. Our assumptions about that are that reading the signs of our times through the lens of faith, that God is speaking a word of expectation to us about the sin of racism. And second, racism is a systemic problem built on and sustained by white supremacy. And ending this injustice is our sacred obligation. And our final assumption is that with God's help, we can be healed, transformed, and renewed to do this work. Now, our intention for this group is to be responsive to the profound realities of racism that challenge the common good, as well as the difficult but respectful and transformative dialogue we need to have with each other about what this means. This is a group in which we can learn from a variety of resources, both books and videos and others, and even more importantly, to learn from one another, and as a result, to grow both individually and collectively. Our hope is that with the presence and guidance of God's Holy Spirit, our time together will be a creative space for respectful dialogue. Debbie.
Thanks, Marilyn. We've decided to, I believe there's a book group or a book club that is just about wrapping up, and they met on Tuesday evening. So we've decided to sort of follow with their schedule. We are going to meet virtually on Tuesday evenings at 6:30 for 1 hour, possibly 90 minutes, depending on group consensus. Our first meeting will be Tuesday, October 16th, and it will go for 6 consecutive weeks, excluding election night. If you have questions, or if you are interested in possibly participating in this group, I would appreciate if you would send me an email, and my email is in the church directory, and I believe Roberta will include it, and Gina will include it in the bulletin in the next couple of weeks. And if you are uncomfortable with email, you can certainly give me a call, and my cell number is also in the church directory. As Marilyn indicated, we will be using a number of different resources for our discussions. The book White Fragility, which many of you, I believe, have read over the summer, will be our initial foundation. And we also will be providing the participants with a video that we think also will give us a great starting point for discussion. And it's a video by Jennifer Harvey, who was a professor, I believe, in Drake University in Iowa, entitled Dear White Christians. And the link to that video, as well as a reminder of the book, will all be in the bulletin in the ensuing weeks. Hopefully I can hear back from you before the 16th, so that we can have an idea of the numbers of people that are participating, and Marilyn and I can sort of figure out how to navigate through sort of the complications of a Zoom call with the number of people that we can expect. So thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks to both of you, Debbie and Marilyn. It's great that you'll be leading us. Thank you for that. Now Stan Harrison is going to give us an update. This has been a busy week for the family in Burien whom we've been sponsoring.
I'm coming to you this morning with some wonderful great news. I think we are getting so much bad news and terrible news just about every day on the news on when I watch TV. But I have some excellent, wonderful, glorious news. The apartment complex that the family, some of you might not know, but we're adopting a family for a year to help them who've been struggling with the pandemic and unemployment and have been living in a shelter for the last 9 months. And we're helping them to be able to get into an apartment and start their life over again. The new trajectory for this family, it's a family that I know very well. We originally came to everyone and asked for a goal of $2,000 a month. We figured that that would be the amount that would allow us to be able to not only pay the rent, water, sewer, and garbage, but also some money set aside to be able to help with childcare. Right now, we've raised just about that amount. When you take a look at the one-time gifts and divide them over 12, and take a look at the monthly goal of monthly contributions that people have given, we are $97 a month shy of hitting the 2000. That is amazing. That's amazing. So we know what we can do. We know what the rent is now, and we'll be able to at least start the childcare. I'm hoping for at least the first 6 months, let the father get back on his feet, and then he can take it over from there. So we're looking at rent for 1 year. And childcare for 6 months. And we are there, folks. This church has rallied around this vision and this passion, and really it's overwhelming for me to be able to be part of this. The apartment complex, they were paying, by the way, this family before they went homeless, they were living in a apartment complex that's meant for the poor, meant for the people, subsidized housing. And they were paying for a little two-bedroom apartment that was, the bedrooms were tiny. You could just barely get a twin bed in them. And it was filthy, very poorly managed. I've been there many times. I have about 8 families from my school who live there. And they were paying $2,000 a month for rent. $2,000 a month for rent for nothing. And because the problem is that they couldn't, anybody could go there, anybody could jump in. But they were evicting people right and left because who can afford that? We were able to come up with an apartment that believes strongly in our vision and our goal to be able to help this family. And with warp speed, they approved this family to get through, and we moved in on Thursday. It was so exciting. The family had an appointment to be able to meet with me on Thursday at 1 o'clock, but I knew that I had contributions from all across, well, there are 3 families that had contributions that I knew that I can get those and get them into the apartment before 1 o'clock time hit. What you see right now is the living room in the upper left-hand corner. Some of the furniture that was there. Also, then you take a look in the on the upper right-hand corner. The family was so excited that when they got into their home that there were games. They thought, oh my gosh, we have our own games. The kids were just thrilled. In the kitchen, it's pretty limited amount of stuff in there right now. But yesterday, the elementary school that is with this family and knows this family very well, they rallied around their whole staff and they've completely furnished the kitchen. Everything that they need for the kitchen is there. We also have applied for Northwest Furniture Bank for all the rest of the furniture. In about 2 weeks, they will be in each one of those bedrooms right now. All you see is in the corner is a blanket, a bed pillow, sheets, and a sleeping bag. Oh my gosh, they were so excited. And the thing is that even though they don't have beds yet, they've lived for a long time without beds. And they said, Stan, the cool thing is that we can sleep on this carpet, it's padded, and this carpet doesn't smell terrible because it's brand new carpeting. They redid the whole carpeting and painted the place ready for this family. They are so excited. And I stopped by on Friday morning with some groceries and some cleaning products and a shower curtain, things like that. It was so funny because they were all sleeping in the living room. They said, Stan, it's overwhelming for us right now because we've gone from a 12 by 12 room for the last 9 months, and then sleeping in the car to now having our own bedrooms. And right now is overwhelming. We're so excited. But for the first couple of nights, we decided we'd all huddle together. And it was so wonderful to know that everything that they needed, bed pillows, blankets, pillowcases. And they were really excited. The two girls were really excited because they got pillowcases with beautiful white lace on them. Everything that the church has given, everything that was given was exactly what this family needs. And in 2 weeks' time, the furniture will come in from the the Northwest Furniture Bank. And all the things came in for the kitchen. They are just totally overwhelmed. This is great news, family, because you've helped this family trajectory for, I believe, forever. One of the things that I'd like to leave you with is that there was one of the children, the younger daughter, on Wednesday, she was crying all day long. The family kept asking her what's wrong, and she says, nothing's wrong, nothing's wrong. She finally was able to put the tears away to talk. She said, I can't believe that this is the last day that we have to live like this. I can't believe this is the last day we have to live like this, knowing that they were going to move into their own apartment tomorrow. And the other thing, the next day, one more thing too, is that now, because of our assistance to be able to help this family, the apartment rent is only $1,500, $1,500, where again, they were paying for a little hole in the wall that was filthy, $2,000. They know now that as a result of us paying for the rent, that they will continue to be able to live there when the lease is up. And they save $500 a month and get a beautiful, amazing place. So again, the trajectory is not just for these coming weeks or months, but I believe for the whole lifetime. These kids are so excited, and they're so appreciative of the people who are helping them. So again, God bless you. Thank you. I felt like Santa Claus on Thursday. It was quite an amazing emotional time for all of us. And again, that would not be possible if it wasn't for your contributions and your generosity. Thank you, everybody.
And it wouldn't be possible without your vision, Stan. So thank you very much for everything you've been doing. Just thank you for sharing this story with us, because it really lifts us. Our international video today comes from Hong Kong. A huge thanks to Michelle Lee, who reached out to her sister and asked her if she would record this for us. Many of us actually met this speaker because Michelle brought her to worship with us a year or two ago. Let's watch together.
Good morning, everyone. This is Fiona. I'm a member of a Christian church in Hong Kong. My sister in Seattle told me that her church has been featuring international videos sharing the lives and experience of people in different parts of the world during the pandemic. I would like to thank the Congregational Church on Mercer Island for giving me the opportunity to share the story of Hong Kong during these challenging times. When he have been experiencing half-year physical distancing, it is really so warm that through this video, we are having spiritual connection with brothers and sisters in miles away. And you will know more about what's happening in Hong Kong, and hopefully you will pray for us. As early as in February, we heard of what's happening in Wuhan. Hong Kong people is very alert to this, as we had the experience of SARS in 2003. We wore masks right away, even the government, that is our chief executive, said there is no such need. And very soon, situation turned worse, border closed, and people worried about short provision of masks and daily supply. Everywhere, people queuing up for buying masks. Hong Kong is a densely populated place. The pictures show you the place where I live. And you can imagine we are in contact with lots of people every day, in the supermarket, in the wet market, in restaurant, and in bank, and so on. Apart from civil servants, many commercial sectors still operate as usual. People have to go to work, public transport are crowded, and couples of weeks ago, the government imposed rules on suspension of dining at restaurant, and that's what happened during lunchtime. And I remember that was a rainy day. What a shame, and I feel so sad for them. However, I must say Hong Kong people is very adaptive. and we are trying to do whatever we can to protect ourselves and protect others. As for our church life, it is amazing. We turn to online meeting very quickly. We have online Sunday worship. We have Tuesday Zoom prayer meeting. We have extra Bible study section on Wednesday night. We have gospel sharing video on Saturday, and followed by Zoom group discussion. Praise the Lord, His work never stops. His work remains to be our light, and He is our refuge and our fortress. The COVID-19 have caused health problems, economic loss, and loss of inconvenience. But to me, it is far less hurting than the unrest political situation in Hong Kong. So I'm going to give the final part of my sharing, which is about our political situation. Many Hong Kong people feel so desperate, helpless, and fragile in front of the public power. Some of you may have heard of the news about Hong Kong. Actually, we are at the edge of life and death of freedom. Now is the freedom of speech, and I personally believe, later on, it may be freedom of religion. Whenever I look at the pictures of the protests in the last 12 months, when I think of those young people in jail and the injured ones, the broken relation between due to different political wills in family, among friends, and even in the church, tears, anxiety, and anger will come out. I didn't show my face on this video because, to be very honest, I don't think it's safe anymore. It is risky to give political views. Many people has already erased their Facebook pages, delete WhatsApp messages. People have no more chance at workplace as their political view might cause job loss, and it did already happen. Teachers, social workers, and medical people are threatened to have their professional status disqualified because of participation in protests. Victims are dramatically accused as rioters. Key political people are arrested. Government disqualified candidate to take part in election, and the whole election campaign is deferred by 1 year. All these seem unbelievable, yet it happens. I have been hiding from news for a while as I can't bear with it. So, at the end of this video, I earnestly seek your support to pray for Hong Kong. We don't know what's next. I feel like we are at the edge of a cliff. No matter what happens, let's have faith in our Lord. He is in control and He can turn problem into blessing. Satan means it for evil, but God means it for good. Glory to our Lord and peace to His people. Thank you to you all in giving me the chance for sharing. God bless you all.
That is such a moving story, and I feel grateful that through our prayers we can reach out a strong hand to her and to the friends that she spoken about through the people in her church. We will indeed be praying for them. But first, can we take a moment just to celebrate? Think back over everything we've heard in the last half an hour. Celebrate the richness of our life together. Who would have thought that it would be like this when in so many ways our lives are so constrained? I think it's pretty amazing. So let's open the chat box, everybody, and share a greeting, a good morning with one another, and may the peace of Christ be with you all. Thank you.
Our first reading is from a book called The Passionate Jesus by Reverend Peter Wallace. A stone is tossed into a still pond, and from its point of entry, ripples and wavelets circle out, wider and wider. In the same way, Jesus entered human existence, piercing the surface between the eternal and the here and now, and love washes continually from him in wave after wave, flowing out beyond him, touching all in its path, and ultimately encircling the whole of creation. God's love surges through Jesus in every direction.
Good morning, everyone. The second reading is a parable of Jesus from Luke chapter 10. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise."
My sermons from now through October will be about feelings. I'm enormously grateful for our new South African friends here most Sundays with us on Zoom, because we see them smiling. They've made it through a winter of lockdown. They can tell us what it's really like on cold, dark nights, what you do to take care of yourself. Because as we start to feel the October chill in the air, I know lots of us are worried about that. Life with COVID has been livable, sort of. While we could go outside and take walks, maybe even meet up with a friend in some breezy, socially distanced kind of way, masks at the ready. But winter, we think about that right now, it just looks like a long, dark tunnel, really. The fear starts to set in. The newscasters say scary things about what may happen to our mental health as the pandemic continues. Have you noticed any signs in yourself? I have. 2 things in particular. I was talking to a clergy colleague earlier this week, and he mentioned that he couldn't sleep. 3 nights in a row, he says, he just gave up about 1 o'clock in the morning, and he got up, just tired of staring at the ceiling. And I said, "Me too." For several nights, all of last weekend, I struggled to fall asleep, and then about 3 o'clock, I was wide awake, and I couldn't go back to sleep again. That's past now, thank goodness. It was really starting to get me down. My clergy friend thinks that there's something bigger unfolding, some evolutionary shift, and our bodies are tuned into changes deeper than our minds can comprehend. Maybe so. The other symptom I've noticed is new and very strange. I like to go for long walks in the morning, listening to books on my headphones. I've tried listening to serious and improving material, history and stuff, but that didn't last. I want to be entertained. So I've had a goofy mystery story this week, which I totally recommend, the latest Simon Brett whodunit, where the hero is one of those people you hire to help declutter your house. I'm putting in my miles liking this book when I realize that my brain is doing something bizarre. Every little twist in the plot is triggering a memory in me. A character bends over to put their shoes on. There's a house with a gravel driveway. Two people get together and share a pot of nettle tea. And my head does these flashbacks. Not nice memories either, but terrible ones. Stupid things I did, awful things I said, cringe-making sermons. There have been plenty of those. A whole barrage of embarrassing and humiliating experiences played out on that screen in my head. I'm walking along, minding my own business, and here I am reliving a big, long, wretched laundry list of things I wish I could forget forever. Why is that happening? What's it about? I don't remember ever experiencing it before, so I hope it ends soon. If these next few months are going to be emotional, and I expect they will be, the last thing I want hounding me is shame. Now, if these next few months are going to be emotional, and I expect them to be, I want to follow Jesus. If my feelings are going to be all over the map, I want to grab hold of his love as home. If, as my friend says, we're all part of something bigger, some evolutionary transformation, let it transform us into Christ. And not a cardboard Christ, remote and detached and superior, but a flesh and blood Christ whose whole being was an expression of love. Did you like that quote that Steve read? I think it's really great. Love washing from Jesus like ripples in a pond, wave after wave, till it circled all of creation, surging from him in all directions. Jesus came to show the world how to love, that same author writes. Maybe if we look to him as winter engulfs us, he will show us. That's sort of the gist of what we're going to attempt in our worship over these next 5 weeks. Do you remember that spice market? According to the internet, the herb associated with love is rosemary. Rosemary for remembrance, yes, but rosemary for fidelity also, for loyalty and tenderness. Brides used to include a sprig of rosemary in their wedding bouquets. Fine place to start. But I like this one better. You make Chinese five spice by combining cinnamon and cloves, Sichuan peppercorns, fennel, and star anise. What a glorious mixture. Sometimes they use ginger or nutmeg or even cardamom or orange peel. They'll sell it to you in the grocery store ready mixed if you don't want to make your own, and I would like to challenge everybody to cook with it this week. Chinese five spice. Make something and send me a photo of what you make. Rosemary dishes are okay too, but the gold star challenge is for Chinese five spice, because I think there was more to the love of Jesus than simple fidelity and constancy. This love is full of nuances and subtleties. It enhances life with vibrancy. It surprises you. So, love. We've got a glut of retired clergy in our congregation. Welcome, Marilyn. Between us, we've preached a whole lot of sermons about love. About 50 of us on this Zoom call, how many sermons on love do you reckon we've sat through? I'm sure you've all heard the one about the Greek words for love, eros, love as desire, the love we feel for something beautiful or someone who attracts us, philia, the love between friends, give and take, transactional love, and agape, selfless love, the one we're all supposed to aspire to. Thank you, C.S. Lewis. Thank you, Martin Luther King. King pointed out that eros and philia, they both serve us very well with our friends and our family, our nearest and dearest, but they aren't much use towards people who intend us harm. You need agape for that. But we've heard all this before. We've got it. Jesus taught agape. Love one another as I have loved you, he urged his disciples. Agape. But when the Gospels talk about what Jesus felt, they use another word, splanchnizomai. If we were together, I'd make all of you try and say it, splanchnizomai. This is love from your gut, your splankna, are your liver and kidneys, your intestines. So Jesus looked out over the crowds, and as splanchniste, he felt the compassion deep in his guts, and he fed them. He looked out at people gathered around his doorway, and esplachniste, he healed them. He looked at a leper, at two blind men, and spechnistes, he reached out and touched them. He saw a widow weeping over her dead son, and esplachniste, he felt her grief in his own body and raised her son back to life. He told a story about a father whose son grabbed his share of the inheritance and went off and went carousing and gambling until it fell into ruin. But the father waited and waited, and when he spotted the boy coming home, esplanchniste, he ran to meet him. And he told a story about a man left for dead by the side of a road and the Samaritan who rescued him. When Jesus and the lawyer discuss the commandment about loving your neighbor as you love yourself at the beginning of the story, that's agape. But when the Samaritan stops and kneels down and takes the man's hand in his own, surely that's esplachniste. Listen to the story with COVID-19 ears and realize how it's our story too. We are all that Samaritan walking down the road. We're okay for the most part. But oh God, all the hurting people around us right now. We stopped when we heard the cries of that family in Burien because their story connected with all this hoagnisomai we've been experiencing ever since the pandemic began. When the schools closed, they went from coping to not coping. Father couldn't go out to work unless he took the kids along in the car, left them sitting there 8 or 9 or 10 hours, took food out to them at lunchtime, depended on them to be good, then drove them home to where, if they were lucky, they had beds to sleep in. We know this story of this Samaritan and his bandages and his donkey and his handful of coins to the innkeeper. Stan is our innkeeper. We have given him instructions, just like the Samaritan. Let us know if there's anything else they need. We're here. We're not looking for thanks or credit or praise or glory. We don't even want them to know who we are. This is pure splanchnisomai. Splanchnisomai compels us. Compassion for what misfortune does to people, what systemic injustice does to an immigrant family. We cannot be whole until that family has a way to live, till those children can learn again, till they can breathe. The compassion we feel is the love of God living in our bodies. Letting that feeling find expression in real outreach to real people is exactly what it means to be a follower of Jesus. It isn't about earning points or passing the agape test. It's about those ripples. We give because of everything others have given to us. We give for the joy of it. And the ripples will keep spreading because that's what ripples do. Love is like that. I think rosemary is too tame to symbolize splanchnisomai. We need the earthiness and complexity and richness and magic of five spice. Buy some if you don't already have it on your shelf. Marinate something in it this week. Marinate it for a good long time. This love we're looking for isn't just something you sprinkle on top. You want it to soak in, to infiltrate your very being, to change who you are. It does good things for meat, I'm told, or if you're not a meat eater, try using it in a pumpkin pie. Send me a photo. Our COVID winter could make us all shrivel up and close in on ourselves. Or it could open us to new expressions of love, love that washes out from us, from our little church, wave upon wave, until it enriches the whole creation. Christ's splanchnisomai surging through us in all directions for justice and compassion and healing. Let it be so. Amen. The soloist in our anthem this morning is Michelle Lee, the same Michelle who has the sister in Hong Kong. She's such a modest person that I'll bet you had no idea she could sing like this. Thank you, Michelle, for touching our souls with this beautiful song. Let's all listen to the words, and as we listen, let's call to mind the people for whom you wish us all to pray this morning. And after the anthem, I will give you time to share their names with the rest of us.
When I'm down and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come, my heart burdened deep, and I am still and wait in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. Restless heart beats so imperfectly, but when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on the street.
Amazing. Michelle, when we're back together, you need to teach us all to dance too. Let's all take a minute or two now to open the chat box and share the names of people for whom we want to pray. If there's a situation in the world that you'd like to add, that's good too. Let's pray together. Oh God, we pray this day for the world that you care for.
We remember 7.25 million people in our country infected with coronavirus and 200,000 dead, and so many more in other countries of the world. We pray for those who are sick, those who are caring for them, and those who mourn.
We pray for the people whom we've named in our chat box. For Sharon, whose mother died in Italy last week. I wasn't able to see them due to COVID. Give prayers for comfort. For Michael, who's struggling with mental health. We pray for ease of mind, for healing. And prayers for Barb's mom in Indianapolis.
Pray for the people of Hong Kong, traumatized by what it has meant to return to Chinese rule. We pray for people like us who are afraid to show their faces, who are canceling their Facebook accounts and erasing politics from their speech for fear of reprisals. We pray for Michelle's sister and the church to which she belongs, that their faith will remain strong as they put their trust in you.
We pray for our cities and our neighbors, for that family in Burien making their home in the new apartment, for the children with their COVID diagnoses and the father caring for them.
We pray for ourselves, for the fears and hopes that fill our lives, for the prayers we struggle to utter and the words that get stuck in our throats. We pray knowing that you hear us better than we are able to pray, asking that you will help us seek and find and fully realize your compassion living within us.
These prayers we offer, words, silence, feelings, and longings, in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to say these words together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sin, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Joy of them too.
all the troubles of these days. Know God's peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to what is good. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Repay no one evil for evil. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord. And whatever happens, know that you are not alone.